I'm Rick Johanson, and this is IronEcho Design. Inkscape is a free graphic design program that helps you make all sorts of complicated designs easily. Here's a few highlights from past tutorials that we've done on this channel. If you're new to Inkscape, if this is your first day trying it out, or if you just want a refresher, or if you tried it years back and hated it, I made this video for you. I'm gonna walk you through step by step all of the basic tools so you can get started quickly to let your creativity flow. We'll go through all of the top bar menus, all the icons, all the control bar menus, each of the basic tools. Plus, I want to highlight some of the most important tips you should know when you get started with Inkscape, and also show you some of the best features you're going to want to play with. The latest version of Inkscape, as of this filming, is 1.2, but if you're watching this far into the future, or if you're using an older version, the layout might look a little bit different, but the fundamentals are the same. All right, you ready? I'm gonna assume you already have Inkscape downloaded. If you do need help with that, let me know in the comments. You're gonna be greeted with the welcome screen. On the quick setup tab, you have canvas, we'll have it set to default, keyboard, default, appearance. I'm on classic symbolic. The only change that I make is I toggle over to dark mode. That brings you over to the next screen, which shows Inkscape is free. You can contribute your time, or you can learn how to fund Inkscape with these icons here. Let's go to time to draw. On the print tab, you'll see all sorts of different default templates. We'll just start with the first one, A4. And here it is. So you're looking at this, you see a lot of icons, a lot of action. Where do you start? Well, let's start in the very upper left-hand corner, file. Go down to document properties. Click on that. This allows you to set up how you want your canvas to look. Right here you see front page format is A4, which is 210 millimeters width by 297 millimeters height. You can change the orientation with the next button. Click it to landscape, gives you a preview here, or leave it on portrait. If you do follow some of my tutorials, I like to change the page color by clicking this right here and changing it to black. That's just a preference because I think it makes the design look more dynamic. But today we'll keep it white. All this space out here, this gray area, that's called the desk. You can change the color on that also if you feel like it. You don't have to do all your designing inside the page. It does come in handy when you export or you want to print, but you can use all this area. Zoom out, zoom in, work a little bit more freely. X out of that. The next tab on the top menu is edit, and it contains everything from the mundane cut, copy and paste to clone, create tiled clones, which I have several tutorials on this. It's not a day one activity, but remember it's there. Why it's under edit, no one knows. While we're here though, you want to go down to preferences because Inkscape gives you a lot of control on how your actual interface looks. Click on the interface and on toolbars. If yours are looking too small or too small to your liking, you can drag the toolbar icon size to make it larger or reverse, make it smaller. I keep it at 150, so hopefully you can see it well enough. Control bar up here, you can drag that larger. See how it's making the icons grow, or you can shrink it down. I also want to point out how to find preferences because there will be times later in the tutorial, and especially as you advance, you're going to want to customize some of these tools, and that is done with preferences. For view, one of the most commented things I got on the last quick start video was how come I have one of the toolbars on the side? And that was just because of a change of Inkscape since the filming and when people are watching it. You might have yours defaulted to widescreen, and here are the toolbars on the side. If you don't want them there, just take widescreen off. Even if the toolbars are on the side, the functionality stays the same. Let's go to layer. You see this here, layers and objects. Click on that and you will get a sidebar. This is the hardest thing for me when I migrated over from Photoshop and started using Inkscape. I wanted to know where is the layer bar. I was so used to having everything stacked in layers, and that is here too. Sometimes it's not as needed in vector design, but it's here. So if you feel more comfortable opening up the layers and objects tab, it's under layers, layers and objects. And this becomes pretty intuitive. This is layer one. If you want to add another layer, click on the plus, add layer two above current, there's layer two. But we don't need that for now. Let's go to the next one, which is object. Brings us to one of the most important menus you'll ever use, fill and stroke. Since so far we've created nothing, we have nothing on the fill and stroke menu. Let's literally get on the same page by zooming in at the exact same ratio. You can use one of these icons, this one right here that looks like a magnifying glass, this pop-up that has the number 5 next to it. The 5 is the shortcut. So I can push the number 5 and now my page is centered and zoomed in. If you're doing this later and you forgot that and you can't remember which of these icons is which, go to view, zoom, zoom page 5. And actually, if you don't even want to use that, there's a shortcut with the mouse. You can hold down control and scroll in to zoom in or scroll out to zoom out. Also, you can hold down shift to scroll left or right. If you're going for precision, just hit 5, zoom page. Not to skip ahead, but I do need an object. Grab the Create Circles and Ellipses tool. I'm going to hold down control, which will lock in the proportions of a perfect circle, and I'll left mouse click and drag open a circle. One of the common questions I get from tutorials is, how come I don't have the circle dial here? Maybe you have these bars, maybe you have something funky like this. When you're on the fill and stroke menu, you'll see the fill tab. Over here, this changes the way color is interpreted. Do HSL, that's the first one, and hit color wheel, and you get your color wheel. The fill color here is yellow. You can change that by dragging around the perimeter, or you can change the values by going inside the triangle here, or if you notice on the bottom, the color ribbon. The rumor is this might be leaving as a default, always being shown, but for now it's here. Click any of these to change the color. Click on these bars here. You see these three bars? Here's some different choices. I usually have it on gold just because, but they have khaki, royal, topographic, and you can even configure your own. For today, I'll keep it on Inkscape default. You see this black line around the circle? That is called the stroke. Click over to the stroke paint tab. Wherever you see this little white circle, that is going to be the color. So if you spin this around and it's not changing your stroke color, move that small white circle out of the black area. Let's make it easier to see. Click over to stroke style. Let's make it 2.0. If you go down to click on the ribbon thinking, hey, I'm on stroke, I'll click a different color. Well, that's gonna change the fill. So how do you make the color ribbon activate stroke? First, we'll put the fill back, hold shift, and when you hold shift and click on the color ribbon, that will change the stroke. Let's go blue, orange, back to black. This X is very useful. Not sure if you can see the pop-up, it says none. On the color ribbon, if I click the X with this object selected, X, no fill. If I hold shift and click the X, there goes the stroke. Another thing I want to show you on the fill and stroke menu, there's two ways to change transparency. At the bottom, see it says opacity 100%. You can drag this slider, it's becoming translucent, or right here. This A, I believe, stands for alpha. See how I drag that? If I go to fill, I have flat color here. 1 over is linear gradient. By default, it's going to take it from whatever the fill color is and take it to transparency. You can slide these over to change where transparency hits. But when you're doing design, sometimes you don't want it to be transparent. If your intention is to change this side to white, instead of having it be transparent yellow, down here on the alpha slider, I'll change that to full opacity. I would make it white color by changing the color itself, or you can go to a different color. I can also add more stops in the gradient. If I double click, I have another stop, which means I can change that color and drag that around. If you think it made it too busy, you can also delete that stop by pushing delete. This whole tangent was coming from the object dropdown. Lots of choices here. Go to the very bottom, align and distribute. This pops up on the sidebar. This is another very useful menu that's going to help you. On the first tab called align, you can move things around relative to, it's set to page. Let me show you how it works. If I have this off the edge by accident, that's that page border. When I modify it relative to page, I can go to the center on a vertical axis, and I can also center it on the horizontal. Here's a second shape. Let's center these up relative to the last selected. If this new rectangle is the first selected, I'll hold shift, click on the other one, which is the last selected. Now, if I center them up, it'll be relative to this one, or align to the left edge of the last selected, or the right edge, or the bottom. It might seem pedestrian, but this comes into play all the time. As we make our way through all the tools and toolbars and everything, when we get to path, this is where I want to share a personal story. I found Inkscape specifically because I was trying to make a vector out of a image. And I didn't include this on the last quick start video. So I'm throwing it in now because it's under the path trace bitmap. Also, because it does explain a key difference between Photoshop, Affinity Photo, those are raster graphic design programs, and then vector programs like Illustrator or Inkscape, like we have here. The big difference is when you have an image, let's say this butterfly, if I zoom in, it's gonna pixelate. That's an image, and with a vector, the biggest difference is you can scale it indefinitely larger or smaller, and it always retains its fidelity. Rather than working with the individual pixels, Inkscape is working with what's called paths. Basically, it's using math to create the design through different shapes. And Trace Bitmap helps us see that. So I've got the butterfly selected here under Trace Bitmap on single scan. Let's change it to actually to multicolor under detection. Mode, let's have it look for different colors. And how many colors do we want to look for? 14. Smooth selected, stack selected, remove background selected. Speckles, smooth corners, and optimize. Smooth corners, bring that down to 50%. Here's our preview. And when I hit apply, it's going to analyze this photo and create a vector for us. While it thinks this image I brought in is under 1 megabyte, if you're bringing in a huge image, it might take a lot longer. It might even crash Inkscape. If you need help resizing, there it goes. If you need help resizing images outside of Inkscape, let me know in the comments. Look at that. With a vector image, if I zoom in, I can see the individual paths. This little path, if I double click, these are the nodes that make the path. Here's a little path. You can change and manipulate the nodes. It's just different tools. Photoshop has its strengths with images and photography. Vector programs like Inkscape will help you with logo design, complex graphics, illustrations. Let's do one more. I want to show you the single scan version. Here is an illustration of a cat. These source images I got, they're just from public domain, from rawpixel.com. And if you're back on Trace Bitmap, single scan, under brightness cutoff, if you want more space, drag it open. The threshold, all it's saying is, hey, I want to look at the brightness, and based on the brightness, make my vector. So if I want to go very, very light, there's your preview, not good. Too dark, it's actually okay. Let's go to 70 something, right there, apply. There it is. Here's our cat. Go back to your fill and stroke menu and change the colors around. Blue cat, what is that, teal cat? And that is day one Trace Bitmap. To finish up the top menu, the next one is text. I'll show you how to use this when we get to the toolbar text icon. Filters is not necessarily a day one activity to go over, but let me just show you what's there. There's different blurring options. You can change the color of your overall objects or your whole project. There is a built-in drop shadow feature, and one that I did quite a bit in previous tutorials, textures. My favorite one's watercolor. You can check out those if you're curious how that works. Going over to extensions, you have a lot more complicated tools that will save for a different time. Interpolate. Here we are back centered up, and remember how I said if you can't remember all these different icons, they are in the dropdowns, but let me just breeze through them real quick. If you click on this first one, that is create a new document, that will open up a whole nother Inkscape. Won't hit that. You can also open up an existing document by clicking here. You can save the document. Print, I'll show you this one. That's where it comes into play what type of page you defaulted with, because I'm gonna hit print. And in the US, the A4 template isn't exactly the same type of 8x11 paper that we use, but it's gonna work. I'll hit print here, and I've got my cat. That's a day one print job. If you're gonna export this to Cricut machine or some type of laser cutting program, there's other defaults you'll wanna do, but for now, just to show you, whatever's in the page, you can always print it with the print icon. The next one is how you can import an image. It's gonna open up a file folder, and you can click on the cat, for instance, open. It brings it back in. Next, one of the most common questions I get. Let's say I made my pretty design in Inkscape. How do I save this as a PNG so I can use it someplace else? If I go to File, Save or Save As, it's just gonna save it as an SVG, but I can't use that. There's plenty of different choices, but how do I just save it as a PNG? It's one of the learning curves with Inkscape. You have to export as a PNG. In my mind, it's the same as saving as a PNG, but they call it export. You can click on the export icon, or if you forget, go to File, Export. A good habit, the first thing I like to do is to make sure I have my actual project grouped together. So I clicked on the cat, I hold Shift, I click on the circle, I can go to Object, Group, and that makes it one selection. If I export as a document or if I export as the whole page, it's gonna send out into the PNG the whole area. That's probably not what you want. Go to selection, and now my PNG will be a transparent background except for the inside the circle. Here's the dimensions. A good practice is 300 dpi, And down here, this is where it's going to go, to this folder. It's going to put the PNG in here. We'll call it cat circle. Push save, which will then give me a pop-up so I can export. The defaults are fine. Okay. Export in progress. And here it is sitting right there. Cat circle. Magnificent. That is how to export to PNG. I do have a full tutorial on that as well. I have tutorials on a lot of this stuff, but I wanted to put it in one complete free class here. What's next? Undo. Everybody loves undo. If I make a mistake and push delete, Control Z will undo it. Or if I move it to the wrong place, you can also just hit this reverse and undo it right there. The next choice pop-up says do again the last undo action, also known as redo. Undo, redo, undo. Redo all day. Moving on, you have copy to clipboard, cut to clipboard, paste clipboard. That's just copy, cut, and paste. We got that. Here's the zooms I was talking about. If I'm zoomed way out and I want to go zoom in to just my selection, I can hit this one. There's the selection. If I had more components to my drawing, they're calling it, I can go to the second one here, zoom to fit drawing. And our favorite zoomed page. If you don't want to affect the zooming, but you want to be centered up, this one right here will center the page without zooming. Center, center. The four squares with the shapes inside, that's going to be group. You hear me say this 1,000 times in the tutorial. Control G, or you can hit up here, group. If that was a mistake, ungroup. Next one is the good old fill and stroke menu. The paintbrush thing in the corner pops up for you. The T brings up a font menu. I don't use this one a whole lot. I prefer just to go with the tool. Goodbye. For some reason, my mind always sees this as plywood, but it's not. It's the layers and objects menu. You've got your code editor, which is not day one. This is day 1,000. Leave that be. Same thing for the next one. View and edit CSS. Not today. And we're back to align and distribute menu. Document properties, which we know, and preferences. Next row, you still with me? This is where it gets a little bit more action-packed here. I've just made some squares. Whichever tool you're on will populate a different set of controls. Here we go with our rundown. We'll start with selector tool. Different ways you can select objects. You can click and drag over an object or click and drag over multiple objects, or you can click on one object, hold shift and collect the rest of them, or if you're in a rush, you can click on this square that looks like a puzzle, select all objects or nodes, and you've captured everything. To deselect, you can double click somewhere off in the desk, or you can hit escape. Sometimes you might have a very intricate design going on, and it's hard to get in there with your box. So there's a couple other options. If you hold alt and you click and drag, you'll get a red line, and whatever your red line touches will be selected. And finally, this one right here, toggle selection box to select all touched objects. That's going to combine the red line that we just did with the selection box. I've got it activated. Now I don't have to go around everything. Anything I touch will be included. Quick interruption. Rick here, 2 days later from the edit bay. I forgot to go over the directionals while we're on the selector tool. So if you have an object, the first directional is rotate 90 degrees counterclockwise if you hit this arrow. Next one, rotate 90 degrees clockwise. The left right one flips it horizontally, and the up down one flips it up and down. Do you see these arrows here? These are pretty intuitive. If I grab a horizontal arrow, I can stretch out the object. If I grab a up and down arrow, I can stretch it that direction. Click off for a second. If you click twice on the object, you get a turning handle. You can grab and drag around to spin the object. And this hash mark, this is the rotation point. It's rotating around that little plus sign, and you can move it. I'll take the rotation point. First, I'll put it down here on the corner. Now when I rotate, it'll go around that pivot point. One more trick that compelled me to come back and reshoot this. Here's a new rectangle. If I click it twice, I see the hash mark. I don't have to put it on the corner. I can stick it anywhere and get my pivot point to make a wider radius. And here's the trick. If I hold control, it's going to limit the places it will actually rotate. The default happens to be 12 increments, so you know you can go to straight, vertical, and the stops in between. Might as well throw one more trick while we're here. I'm not gonna hold control this time. I'm gonna spin it across that pivot point. Anytime I push the space bar, it will stamp out one of the shapes. And that actually works for anything in Inkscape. Here's my shark fin. Can stamp that out. It's making copies. Next up will be hierarchy, and I'm going back to editing. visually you can see how they're stacked up. Well, these hierarchy modifiers, the top one here, if I want to go down one step beneath the teal one, you hit this one. One more step down puts it on the bottom. I can skip right to the top if I go bring the selection to the top. And it works for all of them. So bring it up a step, send it to the bottom. Useful. Back to our simple square. Or is it? If you're not completely sure of the dimensions, you can look up here. Here's width and height. It is not square. Our width is 139 millimeters. Our height is 142. You can change these at will. Let's say I want 150 by 150. Now I know it's square. This brings us to one of the comments I had from over a year ago, which hurt. It hurt, but it was right. The person was right. I didn't talk about this particular icon. Right now, this square, I can make it a set 2.0 millimeters for the stroke. By default, this is enabled. When scaling objects, scale the stroke width in the same proportion. So that means if I make a second one of these, Control D, which is duplicate, if I scale it down, it's gonna keep the width of the stroke in proportion to the size of the object, which is what you want in a lot of situations. But let's say you want it to always be a 2.0. Unclick the scaling stroke function, and now when I duplicate it, if I shrink this down, it looks like it's gonna go in proportion, but when I let go, it goes back to 2.0. All right, next tool is Edit Paths by Node at the most basic level. Since I made this rectangle directly with the rectangle tool, this is where it gets a little confusing. I want to point out at the bottom down here, see underneath the color ribbon, it's saying rectangle in root, which tells me if I hit Edit Paths by Node, I don't see my nodes. I still have these modification anchors. A lot of what you want to do in Inkscape is with paths, go up to Path, Object to path. Now I have four nodes. This is the most basic nature of using a vector program. You can manipulate this shape by dragging the nodes. You can select two nodes at once and change the shape that way. The more you play with Inkscape, the more comfortable you'll be in creating just by using the nodes. And you have a lot of control at your fingertips. I can choose the nodes or I can go in between them, click and drag part of that line, and you'll get a curve. If I don't like this one that comes at a hard angle, I can click on it. Up in the modification area, this one right here looks like a necklace. Make selected node smooth, and it's going to round it for me. These circles coming off of the node, those are the handles that allow me to affect the curve itself. Let's change this one into a curve. Quick time lapse. You get the idea. That's logo design, not my logo, not a sponsor yet. Let's get rid of that. Okay, we did rectangle. Let's go back to circles. One of the most common pitfalls people encounter when they're trying out Inkscape, it's how to use the path functions. And I'm including this on day one because you do need to know these if you're going to be able to use Inkscape the way it's meant to be used. If I do Control D, that will duplicate my object. If I hold Shift and Control together, it will scale it down in proportion around the center. The larger circle selected, the one on top, is also selected. Go to Path, Difference, and it knocked out the center. I'm showing this first because it's easiest to follow. This is something you might commonly want. Now let's go through all the path functions. Keep in mind, path functions work on paths. Let's run through them. Got these two paths selected. Path, the first one, union, that's gonna combine the two elements. For difference, path, difference, that cuts out the overlap. Intersection is interesting. It creates a new path based on the part that intersects. Exclusion knocks out the center part. Path division I use quite a bit. So I've got two different parts here. Kind of cool for logo design. Cut path. Cut the bottom path stroke into pieces, removing the fill. Similar to division, but now the stroke has been chopped up. And combine is very useful, or has been useful for a lot of the tutorials we've done. Path combine. When you're combining two paths that have an overlap, there's two choices you have. If you want it to look like this, when you're on the Fill tab, you keep it on this setting here. It looks like this bent curve. Any path, self-intersection, or subpath will create a hole in the fill. But if you want to combine those two paths and not have that hole, you click on this one, and it stays all filled in. For day one, that may not mean much, but remember that it's there. I know I'm throwing a lot at you, but I want to make sure this is comprehensive so you can revisit this. Save this video, revisit it. Maybe I'll reference it in future tutorials. Let's go to the stars and polygons tool. Up in the modification area, you have a choice. You can go on to polygons. I can open up an even pentagon here. It's taking in the last style, so we want to change the color. Go back to something yellow, and the stroke can be black. After changing the color, you say, what happened to my polygon control area? Just go back to the tool icon. If you're ever missing your control bar, click back on the tool. You have some choices. You can change the number of corners. Let's do 8. There's your octagon. Maybe we'll do 6 for a hexagon. You can round the sides. Let's go to 1.0. I see a node here. If I grab that, it's going to change the scale. Let's do a 0.5 rounded. And that's going to warp it out, 2.0 rounded. Any time for a lot of these tools that you play with it too much and it messes up, this little thing here, reset parameters, that'll bring it back to the default. It actually defaults back to star, which is fine. So we'll be on star. Let's make it 25 points. Spoke ratio. You can bring that spoke in more or bring it out with the plus minus. Or you can choose edit paths by node and you can pull the spokes with that new node that pops up. There's a project we did where we made a vector flower. And you can randomize where all these points go. So we'll do just a little bit. It looks like a mess, but it actually gave us that organic variation that we needed when we multiplied this 100 times. Next tool is the 3D boxes. I'll overlay the tutorial we just did on this a couple months ago. And basically, if you click and drag towards the center of the page, you'll get a 3D shape with vanishing points. Up in the control area, you have angle X, angle Z, and angle Y. The default has angle Y in parallel. This vertical is gonna go to infinity going straight where the two sides go to a vanishing point. For today, let's keep it like that. If you grab the X in the center, you can swing it around and see that 3D box render in real time all these different shapes. And just like you'd suspect, each of these nodes lets you pull the box a different way. Bring it way up for a building. You can also change your vanishing points, but then you're gonna get into some perspectives that may not be perfectly accurate, but do whatever you need to do. One more trick here, let's flatten this down, make it kind of wider. If I do Control D to duplicate this, I can then take that one that's now on top and bring it forward. Control D, duplicate that, I can bring that one up. Control D, and you can kind of see you've made an interesting design happening right in front of you. If I want this one to slide behind there, go back to selector tool, drop it down a step. Okay, what's next? We got spiral. Let's clear this out. Spiral is a nice built-in thing to have. This is the default, just gives you a simple spiral like that. You can put a fill on it. Let's not yet. For stroke though, we'll make it a little bit easier to see. We'll do 2.0, maybe 1.0, and let's add to it. So the number of turns default is 3. Let's go with 20. Now it gets a little bit hypnotic. You can take the outside node and unwind some of it. The inside node, inner radius, you can adjust. If I want more blank space inside, I might do 0.5. It opens it up. If I want to put it back, I can pull that inner node to wherever I feel like it should be. Divergence is pretty interesting. The pop-up says how much denser, sparser the outer revolutions are. 1 equals uniform. So it's at 1 right now. It's all nice and even. Let's see what happens if we change it to 2. That looks a little bit more natural, like almost a seashell type thing. Let's go to 0.5. And this looks something more machine made. Let's change it to 50 turns. Yeah, look at that. What happens if we reduce the width? 0.75, add some color to that. Spiral is a nice tool to have in your arsenal if you want to make this type of circular design on the fly quickly. Delete, and it's time for one of the most important tools, the Bezier pen. Draw Bezier curves and straight lines. I do have a dedicated tutorial to this. I recommend checking that out. It goes way more in depth on how to use it. I actually have some exercises you can try. But for now, here's a day one look to start. We're gonna do left mouse click once, and that's it. Just click and let it be. You have a red square. If I move the mouse without touching anything else, it's gonna show you where that line will go. To end the line or the curve, double click. You made a straight line. Let's do a curve now. Click it once, don't touch anything. Now when you bring it out, if you click and drag, it's gonna start the curve. And we'll take it just there for now, double click. And there you have the two simplest things you can do, a straight line and a curve. Let's look up in the control bar now. That mode, the default mode, is create regular Bezier path. Go to the next one, create spiral path. If I click it once, now when I drag it out, I have a blue line. If I click and drag, it's gonna make a huge circle, or if I keep clicking, lots of different circles. Delete. A more common mode you're gonna be using is create B-spline. This is very useful if you're trying to trace something. Bring an image in here. One way to remove a background from an image or illustration is to create a stamping shape and clip the part you want out of the image. So let's do it. I'm on create B-spline path. For clarity though, I'm gonna change it so it's gonna have a green fill. Change the opacity down to 50%. This is how it works. The B-spline is going to curve automatically. So each time I click, it bends with it. And if I double click, you can start to see this is what I'm creating. And you don't have to do it all in one go. I'm still on Bezier pen. I'm on the B-spline. If I hover over the end node, I can just keep going. If I feel like taking a break, double click. Now I've got this part covered. Okay, through the magic of editing, I'll finish up Rushed a little bit, but to show you what it can do, now I have this green overlay. If I hold shift and get the image, I can clip it out by going to Object, Clip, Set Clip. And there it is, our fish with no background. That's one of the many uses of Bezier pen, but check out that full dedicated tutorial if you want more. On to pencil. Pencil's a fun little tool. Our starting mode is the regular mode. And if I just draw a line, it's gonna adopt, looks like that green that we had from before. The modification choices you have here are smoothing and shape. Smoothing is just what it sounds like. If I draw a line with a higher smoothing, let's say 50%, I can make it jagged and it evens it out. Let's go to 90 and see what happens. I'll go real jagged and a nice and easy curve there. Shape, if I go to triangle in and I draw a line straight down, it's beginning the line as a full triangle and coming out to a little point. Let's make that wider. For scale, we'll go to 3.0. Make a new line straight down and you can see the beginning of the triangle out to the point. The opposite, triangle out. If I pull down this time, it does the tail to the full beginning of the triangle. I'm gonna skip ellipse. You can try that on your own from clipboard. Watch what this does. Now, what was on the clipboard? We'll find out if I click and drag. Looks like we had that rectangle. With every pencil drawing I do, it will make another object from the clipboard. And if I draw it way out, it'll stretch it way out. That is from clipboard. If I go bend from clipboard, it's gonna also take the properties of, let's actually see what's on the clipboard. Control V to paste. Looks like it's this, what do we use that for? Oh, the path function. Okay, so now I'm on pencil, I wanna bend from clipboard. Now watch what happens. Drawing this line, it's bending off of that clipboard object. One of the Inkscape YouTubers, Adam Bellis, has a very cool tutorial using this tool, so check that out. I forgot to mention one of my favorite parts about pencil. If you hold control and click on the mouse once, you get a single dot, and that actually comes in to be useful more often than you might think. All right, let's move on to the brush. Draw calligraphic or brush strokes. Inkscape gives you a lot of freedom to customize your calligraphic pen, but today we'll just stick with the presets. So the first one is dip pen, and it looks like this, almost like an old-timey quill type pen. You can still change the width and it won't change off the preset, but if you play around with any of these modifications, it'll kick over to no preset. So for today, stay on one of the built-in tools. Let's check out marker. Looks just like a marker. Brush. This I should show you some more detail. Thinning, negative 40. The pop-up says how much velocity thins the stroke. What that means is the speed that you move your mouse will affect the thickness of the line. For brush, if it starts at negative 40, let's make that positive 40, and I'll drag it slowly at first and then speed up. Slow, fast. Okay, so a positive thinning value will thin it with speed. It's a very nuanced tool. I'll let my hand go naturally. There we go. Little flick of the wrist there. Okay, so there's brush, but you see how the second I change thinning, it goes to no preset. Let's stay back on track. Let's go to wiggly, and wiggly does this action. Finally, splotch. I wrote splotchy. Huge. Okay, so that's with 100 width. Don't know why that's the default. Try 25. It's kind of cool. There's splotch. Let's move on now to the next tool, create and edit text. Create and edit text is exactly what you think. Text. I'm on a Google font called Enter. I'll change it to Arial. Everybody should have that. And we'll go to bold. I can tell my kerning is a little tight here. If I go up to the modification area under spacing, click there. Here we can see the first box spacing between letters is set to negative 10. Let's make that 0 and it spaces it out better. Let's try 20. Gives us even more room. And here's a trick. I think the first video I made was this trick. If you put the cursor between two letters and hold Alt, you can use the arrow keys to manually change the kerning, adding more space or making less space. You can also, if I hold Alt again, go up or down. So up arrow, if you wanted to have it offset like that. Get rid of this. I want to show you how you can curve the text around a circle because there is one key point I forgot in the last video when we did this. First, I'll make our circle. This is just going to be a guide circle. Stroke will be green, fill will be blank. We'll write our text across the top here. Wrap text. You can see it copying the same style as the guide circle, which we don't want. So we'll do a black fill, no stroke. And the kerning is crunched in again. Negative 10, go to 0. This is how easy it is to do. I'll take the text, I'll hold shift and grab the circle up on the text dropdown, put on path. And there it is, it's upside down. I can grab the guide circle and twist it around the right side up. And here's the part I left out. If you move wrap text off, if you delete the guide circle, you're gonna lose the effect, see? So people were following along and then having that happen. The way you wanna lock this curve in is go to path, object to path. Now this is independent and not linked to the guide circle. I'll do another one now, and the text this time will be bent on the bottom of the circle. Here's our new guide. For the bottom circle, the way it's going to bend in on itself, I actually want to space it out more, so we'll do 10. I feel like the two are going to bump, so we'll scale it down. Right about there, text selected, guide circle selected, text put on path. Same as before, so how do you flip it? Go to object, flip vertical. Now I can grab my guide circle here, get my handles, and put it into place. Until I change it from path object to path, I can still retype it or add more characters or change the kerning or turn it. Now the step I forgot before, once you have it the way you like it, path object to path, get rid of that circle. Let's go to the next tool, create and edit gradients. Here's a quick rectangle. Now you saw before, if I click over to linear gradient, I can then change the gradient so it looks the way I want it to. And you have this new bar up here, but the old way was to have the gradient bar, which you get by clicking on the create and edit gradients. Now I can change the directions and visually I can add different stops. This bar will do the same as this new visual layout. And that's a quick demo of the gradient, but let's say you intuitively want to bend this line. Well, then you're thinking the right direction. The next tool is create and edit meshes. I have a new rectangle. If I go to create and edit meshes, the first choice on the modification area is a mesh gradient. I can drag, and based on whatever you have up here, that's what you'll see. One row with three columns, Control Z. Let's change that to 2 by 2. That's a little bit more useful for our purposes here. And the same as before, each node corresponds to what color you put on it. So right here, it's on full white. Let's change that to something red. Sticking with the center one, you can drag it around and bend that gradient. Or I can select one of the corner nodes, hold shift, get a second corner node, and they'll change color together. I'll click on this upper node here. You can use an eyedropper if there's a shade that you like inside of your mesh already. And that's a day one look at the edit meshes. Next tool, eyedropper, or pick colors from an image. I'm going to combine the eyedropper talk with something we haven't discussed yet, snapping. There's many uses for eyedropper, and one of them is it allows you to create easily your own color palette. So let's make a square. Give it a white fill for now, and stroke will make black. Eyedropper is here on the fill and stroke menu, or also on the toolbar. Hovering over the image, I'll get one of the darker colors I see, this dark green, and it changes our square. So here's where snapping comes in. Up here, this magnet thing with electric lightning bolt in the middle, that's the snapping button. If you hit this delta, it's gonna give you a lot of choices, but for now, just consider snapping on. On the most basic level, if I Control D duplicate my square, With snapping enabled, you see that? It just tried to snap into the side. It's gonna click in. It clicked right in there. Very useful if you're trying to line things up quickly. I'll go back to eyedropper, take a lighter green, Control D duplicate, bring this up, snaps in the center point, snaps right onto the other one. Eyedropper, lighter. I'm gonna zoom in and show you how the snapping can sometimes be too powerful. If I don't want it to be perfectly bound, keep saying bounding box corner to bounding box corner. It's fighting me to get locked in there. A lot of times you don't want snapping. The quick fix is just unselect the snapping. If you're doing something like this with precision and you do want it on, but temporarily you want it off, rather than fight it, you can hold Alt. And during that time period where you're holding Alt, snapping will be off. When I take my finger off of Alt, then it wants to come home right there. For a different day, if you click on the Delta, you can see all the different ways you can snap. Snap bounding boxes, you can snap to nodes, other points, different alignments, all different ways to help you get things where you want them. Okay, everybody, we've made it to Paint Bucket. I used to give this tool a hard time, but I actually do use it from time to time for certain situations. At first glance, the highlight says fill bounded areas. It's gonna take on whatever the last color was. So the last thing I'd made was this square right here. So that's what it's gonna dump out. In the modification area, I have fill by visible colors. You can choose a color, do saturation, lightness, alpha. Stick with visible colors, threshold 25, grow, shrink, zero. Close gaps, none. And I'm going to dump inside of this blank rectangle. And there you go. You have a new vector shape that you made with Paint Bucket. I put this blue circle here to show you that if you make a change on some type of object, let's say I change that to something yellow, and I go to Paint Bucket, now I'm going to be dumping yellow. You can define the attributes by double-clicking on the tool and make it have its own style. But if you're just starting out, you're going to be encountering it and say, why am I dumping yellow now? This right here is text, live text. I can instantly make a vector out of it by dumping paint on it. And if you don't want the fill, turn the fill off. Now you've got your outline there. Edit paths by node, and you can make adjustments. Another application, I'm still on fill visible colors. If I click inside of this area, it will make a new shape based on what it sees. It sees this weird blue shape. Click in that area. Ha, I'm gonna leave this in. Last thing I had was that outline of the A, so that's what it dumped. If I click on the circle, make any type of adjustment, that means the last style I use is this orange. Go back to Paint Bucket into the blue area, and there you go. A new shape based on what it saw, the visible colors. Paint Bucket also has tracing properties. If you have an image and you only want these weird blue areas, I can go down to blues, threshold 25, click on a blue. Got these funky shapes here. You can change these as you wish. Do one more. We'll choose the red. So we'll isolate the reds. Threshold 25 did really well on that one. Got almost all the reds. And you've got this. Let's go on to one of my favorites, tweak. Tweak objects by sculpting or painting. Turn snapping off for tweak and sculpt. And here's what you get. If you click on the tool, width is going to determine how big this circle is. Force determines how much of an effect is going to happen. And here's all your modes. Move objects in any direction. Let's do this one first. You do have to select the objects that you want to play with. So I've got these selected here. I'm on tweak, move any direction. And if I click, they'll just shift around based on where I push them. Click and hold and throw them everywhere. Next one, move objects towards cursor. I'll stay on this row. See how they come in? They're shrinking in. Fascinating. Next one, move objects in random directions. Jumbles them up. This one, shrink objects, shift to enlarge. With 50% force, I'm gonna click and shrink that one down. Hold shift to enlarge. Make that one bigger. All right, let's grab this row. Tweak objects, rotate objects. We'll skip a couple of these. I do use roughen parts of paths, but it does tend to crash Inkscape if there's too many nodes or you have too much action going on. So give that one a try, but save before you do it. What the heck, we'll just give it a try. Seems to be working well. There's only four nodes. Let's actually try to crash it. If I go to edit paths by node, I can see the four. I'll highlight all four of them. And this one right here, insert new nodes. Let's make a bunch. Now we've got 64 nodes. Now if I have it selected and go to my tweak roughen, didn't even crash. Inkscape improving all the time. Last two, I'll highlight this group right here, jitter the colors. Interesting enough. For this last row, we'll do the actual sculpt. Got it selected, width 20, force 50, push parts of paths any direction, and we can just kind of melt them together, bend it out of place. Got some ugly colors here. Let's brighten this up a bit. I'm gonna go to one of my favorite tools, spray can. Spray can, spray copies or clones of objects. First mode says spray copies of whatever the initial selection is. I'll click the teal square and the width is set to 10. That means this orange circle, I can make it larger so you can see better. There's the spray area now. Amount 25, it doesn't actually shoot 25 per click the way it says, but it's gonna try to. 50% rotation variation, 75% variation on the scale. Scatter one, focus one. Keep the eyeball open and the eye shut. Selected, don't worry about the rest. This is the selection, and I'm gonna spray out copies. You can see there are copies, each one's its own individual thing. The difference, if I go to the second mode, spray clones, now the empty box is selected. When I shoot these out, looks pretty cool, and on the fill and stroke, if you change the original, they all change with it. If you change the size, or the scale, or the shape, they all change. Those are clones. The third mode, spray objects in a single path, it will automatically combine them all. Interesting shape right there. A lot of cool applications. Let's now go to the eraser. Hit the eraser button. First mode, self-explanatory. Delete objects touched by the eraser. This is an object. I touch it, it's gone. Control Z. Kids asleep, back from dinner. Let's continue on. The second mode for eraser, cut out from paths and shapes. Let's change the width to something smaller, maybe 10. And when you drag, you'll not only erase the part that you drew over, but it will create new shapes in its place. Go up to path, break apart. And each component is a standalone part. If you're used to Photoshop and you want to actually erase whatever you're dragging over intuitively, that's the third mode, clip from objects. Now, if I scribble over an area, it will take out that part. It also works on images. If for some reason you wanted to clip something out, go to the third mode and we'll erase this middle tree. All right, that will lead us to create diagram connectors. I have a feeling this is someone's favorite tool from the scientific community because I can see it being a time saver for specific charts, flow charts, or things of that nature. If I go to the first mode, make connections, avoid selected objects. When you hover over the question, whatever the question is, you could go to yes or no, and to draw the line, click on it. It automatically knows to take you to the center of the other box, and it puts the connector right in there as it was stated. Avoiding the object. Same thing for the other side. I click on the white centered box, this white centered box, and we have our connector. If this is your favorite tool, I'm glad it's here, but we can move on. We'll go to ruler, measure objects. I actually highlighted this tool in a recent tutorial, the Celtic knot. It's handy in a pinch to physically measure between two points just by dragging. It's gonna tell you on the screen 20.44 millimeters. That's good to know. This one over here, 31.14. I like it. I like it because it's almost like having a tactile, tangible ruler right on your desktop here. And for day one, just wanted to show you that it's there. Second to last tool, the zoom feature. Zoom in or out. Taking us back to the wilderness, the default will zoom in when you click. The more you click, the more you zoom. If you hold shift, it'll click out the same pace. And there is one key feature here. If I was looking at these roots over here, and I liked this zoom, and I zoomed out, this button right here, go back to previous zoom, it lets you scroll through the zoom history. If you're gonna be doing screen recording, sometimes it helps if you zoom out in error, you can get back to that previous view. You can also see a repeat of the zoom icons we had here. So if I wanna go all the way back to the page centered up. I hit that. Here it is, there's some strokes and everything on there. Clean this up. I'm gonna give a specific shout out to Martin Owens. He created this last tool, create and edit document pages. Simply, it lets you have multi-page. So if you hit the plus, now you can create documents with more than one page. You can move them around, you can reorder them. Very, very impressive feature added to Inkscape that gives us even more control of the projects that we wanna make. Hopefully you found this helpful. Leave comments if you have questions If there's something you're stuck on, if I missed something, let me know. I want to give my shout outs and thank yous also, besides Martin Owens, to Logos by Nick, the first channel that got me into Inkscape. Chris Hildenbrand, he contributes to the community in many ways. His channel is 2D Game Art Guru, Davies Media Design, and also Adam Bellis. We all learn together. It's fun to do and enjoy. See you next time.